welcome, everybody. We're really excited to have you here today. Today you're going to hear from General Brown, Ms. Kathy Warden, and Andrew Hunter. Just a few rules of the road. This is on the record. They are going to offer a few remarks, and then we're going to turn it over to allow you to ask some questions. If you'd like to ask a question, please raise your hand, and then a microphone will be brought to you. We are videotaping this with Combat Command. So with that, Kathy, I'd like to turn it over to you to provide a few remarks.
Thank you, Lucy, and thank all of you for being here with us. This is a very exciting day for the Northrop Grumman and U.S. Air Force team. We are here to roll out the B-21, which is the most technology-advanced weapon system of this 21st century to replace the B-2 bomber. And we are extremely excited to have a rich historic heritage of working on the bomber fleet with the Air Force, and even more excited tonight to be able to show you what the future looks like, because in many ways we are taking technology from the future and bringing it to the here and now with this aircraft. It's not just about what the technology advancement of the aircraft means, but it's also about how we went about developing this aircraft. Very much a partnership with the U.S. Air Force that was based on transparency and trust, working together and sharing data early and often. To give you a couple of examples, we iterated on thousands of designs for this aircraft in a digital environment before selecting the design that would go forward. We also have been testing elements of this aircraft in digital form before building hardware, which has allowed us to take risk out of the program and helped the program to achieve its schedule and cost objectives. But maybe what's most exciting for me is this aircraft, once delivered, will be easily upgradable and more cost-effectively sustainable, because we know most of the Air Force life cycle costs are in that sustainment phase. And we learned a lot from the B-2 that we've applied to the B-21 in that regard. The thing that I'm most excited about this evening is that the thousands of people who have worked on this program are finally going to get to share the work that they've done over the last 7 years to build this aircraft. And I think many of you know we have a rich heritage in the Antelope Valley. We have nearly 8,000 employees who are working here at this site, and 400 suppliers in 40 states across the U.S. who have helped us in this journey. So we are here to thank them this evening, and again, to show all of you the work that we are so proud of.
A little bit of a mic, but hopefully when we transition to General Brown, that mic issue will dissipate. So General Brown, if I may ask you to provide some remarks.
Well, thank you. Kathy, thank you so much, and thank you all for being here. And I, again, want to thank the Northrop Grumman team that made all this possible in collaboration with the United States Air Force. This is a tremendous milestone for the Air Force and for the nation. When you think about the B-21 Raider and what it's going to be able to provide, it's a real product of collaboration. A collaboration between the Department of Defense, between industry partners led by Northrop Grumman, and the United States Air Force to bring this capability that's an imperative to our national security. As I think about the name Raider, and 80 years ago, the Doolittle Raiders and what they were able to accomplish, and 75 years of Air Force history, to be able to bring this capability forward this evening with all the work, all the employees between the United States Air Force and Northrop Grumman to make this a highly capable aircraft that is really capable of long-range aviation, long-range strike, that provides options for ourselves as the United States, but also with our allies and partners, particularly in contested environments. I know we have an enduring commitment that we'll continue to work not only in this first airplane, but the number of airplanes that will be eventually delivered to the United States Air Force. And I can tell you that we're very excited to have our partnership with Northrop Grumman to bring this capability to our airmen. I'm also appreciate the defense industrial base and the things they've been able to do to be able to take some of the techniques that Kathy described, because it's going to change the way we do things here in the future, how we bring capability, and it shows the strength of our industry partners along with our military as well. When I think about accelerate change, this is exactly what it means. To be able to bring this kind of capability very quickly and be able to, as Kathy said, to be able to adapt vis-a-vis the threat. And so today, I'm really excited that we bring the B-21 Raider into the future. It'll be the future backbone of our bomber fleet, and really appreciate the opportunity to be here this evening and be part of this very historic day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Hunter.
Well, thank you, Chief, and thank you, Kathy. And I really want to say that we have to thank really thousands of people who have worked on this program from the Department of the Air Force, from the Defense Enterprise, and from our industry partners across a wide range of companies that have really contributed to this effort. And I think what that demonstrates is our ability to apply the tremendous technical know-how, the talent in government and industry to our critical operational needs and realize them in the form of a platform that we're moving towards a fielded, delivered capability in the near term. And it's really great to be here in this historic location, Air Force Plant 42, where we have a history of doing this, and we have a workforce that's longstanding that has facilitated us being able to do this with multiple platforms and many of the Air Force's most advanced aircraft over time. And it's a perfect place to unveil the B-21 Raider. And as the Chief said, what we're seeing with the B-21 Raider is a fielding of a long-range penetrating capability that will allow us to carry out our missions in the Indo-Pacific theater and in all parts of the world where the Air Force needs to operate and provide the capability the Joint Force requires in those theaters. The B-21 will allow us to deliver that capability on day one, but it's also been developed and been produced in a way that allow us to deliver that capability over time. So as the missions that we have to perform change and as the threat evolves, the B-21 will continue to be able to perform that mission for the long term. So we're going to be able to do that in a way that is allows us to adapt over time to new technologies and new capabilities. And we're going to do it in an affordable way. One of the key aspects of this program is that we had a very firm cost target that is a requirement for the program. And that will support our ability to deliver the number of aircraft we need to truly perform the missions that are outlined in the National Defense Strategy for the Air Force. And I look forward to your questions.
Great, thank you, and appreciate again. Really excited to have all of you here. Hopefully you've had a good afternoon of touring around. We're just getting the microphone so that we can ask some questions. We're gonna start at the back if we could. Jessica.
Okay.
Tara. Tara.
Hi, thank you for doing this. Tara Kopp with the Associated Press. When you talk about cost, was there ever any consideration for any other aircraft shape other than the flying wing, or is that one the most optimal design, and did it allow you to stay under cost?
So I'll start in terms of design and ask the Chief or Andrew to chime in. We iterated, as I said, on thousands of designs before picking the design that met the aircraft requirements, and the flying wing is the best alternative for meeting those requirements and affordability targets. But first and foremost, we needed to deliver on the low observability range so that the mission could be performed. And while cost is an important requirement, the designs that we were iterating on mostly could fit within that cost envelope, and I'm pleased to say that we are on track to meet those cost KPPs as well while delivering the capability needed.
So we're going to try to keep it to one.
I would just add to that we did a competitive process for this program, so there were different designs originally proposed, and this design was the winning design.
We are going to try to keep it to one question just because we do have limited time. I'm going to come to this side of the room. Brian, you have a question?
Thank you. Brian Everstein with the Aviation Week. We've heard that this is the first sixth-generation aircraft. We've heard a lot of the development of how this represents the future of stealth. How has the understanding of what stealth is impacted this design? How much of it is a focus on, you mentioned the flying wing, on LO, or how much more of it is on the electronics on the aircraft?
Well, I think two things in answer to that. It has always been a core to the mission that it be a penetrating bomber. So LO has been absolutely central to the entire design process, and it was a central factor in in selecting the winner for this capability from the beginning. And the ability to continue to perform that mission, it will need to evolve as the situation evolves, as the security environment evolves. And that's where the adaptability of the platform will enable us to continue to do that. And we do that with open mission systems, approaches, open architectures that allow us to incorporate new electronic systems on the platform as needed, and also with a digital acquisition approach that Kathy referenced.
Great, and I hope you all appreciate we have to use wired microphones, so have patience with us as we move people around with the wired.
Allison?
This is Allison Gatlin with the Antelope Valley Press. And I guess this is for both you, Mr. Hunter and Ms. Warren. Wondering if there is still a target of 100 or more bombers eventually, and how would this affect the work here in Palmdale? How will you need to continue to ramp up, or how will that affect the long term of this facility?
Well, as the chief of staff with the responsibility of the organized training and equipment, we set the requirements. 100 is the number we're shooting for, and that's the program as we develop this is to get to 100 aircraft. And I'll let Kathy talk about the employees and how that impacts what they're doing here.
Yes. So we have more than doubled our team here since 2015 after winning the B-21 Raider program. And as we look forward and move into production, we will need to continue to increase staffing as we increase the rate at which we're producing.
And I would just add to that that, the Palmdale area at Air Force Plant 42, we have a number of critical and industrial-based capabilities here. And so, as Kathy had said, this program is growing. There are other programs that are important to the Air Force that are growing. And so this area is going to continue to have to help us meet that need.
Great. Thank you. If we can come into the front row, Jessica, again, have patience with us since we have a wired. I saw Doug put his hand up, and I've got Tony or
Tony?
Tony Capacio with Bloomberg. So an event like this, there's a lot of enthusiasm about what this plan is going to bring. But I'd like a reality check from you, Chief. A lot of people are going to look at this and say, oh, the Air Force, at the end of the week, after they unveiled the China military report, unveiled this bomber. There's going to be a lot of connections that this is going to be a ready tool of instrument, a tool of a national power fairly soon. Can you give a reality check on the operational and developmental test hurdles this plan has to go through, and a realistic, rough IOC date? And for Ms. Warden, from a sales standpoint, what's your projection on after B-21 sales percentage for going into 23? I saw a Jeffrey's analysis saying it could be as much as 22% of Northrop sales.
I'll start without giving you into classified pieces, but first deliveries will be in the mid-20s, and we'll continue to build out that capability. When I think about the test points, the beauty of what Kathy described of being able to use this digital approach, it allows us to do many, to de-risk some of the tests that we would normally have to do, and it's really a change in culture. This is something Andrew and I have talked about, the aspect of, because of all the digital information and the work we've done, the test points that we would typically do in a traditional program don't need to be as many, and that's a part we got to think through, and it's a cultural shift as well. Because you get it, for our test community, they like testing. And so the aspect of how do we then transition ourselves to this digital approach where we use the data, and we're seeing it as they're building the aircraft. And having been here to visit the factory in part of the production for the test vehicles, I've been able to see some of the approaches they've taken with this digital architecture as well.
And in terms of the B-21, it's an important part of our company's revenue, but it's only about 10% of the company today. And as we look into 2023, that's relatively stable. We've spoken about that in public forum, and we expect it to scale over time, but we'll still be one of several important programs within the company.
Great.
I would just add in terms of your point about a reality check that we are going to enter into a new phase of the program. We're going to do flight test. We're going to learn things in flight test. We learn things as the aircraft that's being unveiled was assembled, and we're going to continue to learn things. But overall, the program has been tracking very well to plan, and so we're meeting the key elements of the schedule that the government had established.
Great, thank you. We're going to come over to this side of the room. I'm trying to be equal here. John, if I could bring the...
John Turpak here, Air and Space Forces Magazine. Mr. Hunter, can you talk about what the potential rate could be for the B-21? Is it facilitized for, are you facilitized for only a certain number, or could you expand if the threat increases? And that's my question.
Yeah, I don't want to get into production rates today or probably in the near future, but we have facilitized to the production rates that we are, that are planned, that get us to the number of aircraft that the chief identified. We do have some room if there were a decision made at some point in the future to go to a higher number.
Great. I think Dan has a question over here. Yeah. Then I'll come over here. I think we have time for just two more questions.
Thanks for your time. Dan Lamoth, Washington Post. Quick point of order and then a question. Are you still at six, kind of in progress and development at this point? More significant question. The unmanned piece of this puzzle in terms of this aircraft flying unmanned at some point, can you characterize the degree to which that's a priority at this point and the timeline that might be on as well? Thanks.
So in terms of the six number that you referenced, so there are six test aircraft for the program, and that number is holding steady. As I mentioned, we're just about to get into test flight, but I don't anticipate a change in that number. And then as to the crewing, the requirements that were established long ago, early on in this program by Secretary Cates, talked about, you know, optionally manned. But it's always been the focus to ensure that that we have the ability to have a crewed aircraft as the primary focus.
Okay, we have time for one more. Jessica, if you can help me.
Laura,
in the middle row
did
there.
You have a question you wanted to ask? Laura? Question? Okay.
Hi, Laura Heckman, Rapid City Journal, and Raider Country, home to Ellsworth Air Force Base. So my question is kind of regarding the name of this plane and where that history came from. We've talked a lot today about the advance and future of the technology this plane is using. Kind of the opposite, what can you speak to what has remained consistent about the Raider spirit that we hear a lot about at Ellsworth, of innovation and boldness, and then also how this aircraft is going to carry that forward?
So for many of you, some of you may know that back in 2015, Secretary James, Secretary of the Air Force, we actually went out and asked for recommendations for name. They got about 2,000 inputs, and we boiled it down to Raider. Dick Cole, the last of the Doolittle Raiders, was still alive. He was there at that particular ceremony. Think about the Doolittle Raiders and what they're able to do. Just a handful of months after the attack on Pearl Harbor, for the very first time, he put a bomber on a carrier and struck into Japan. That's innovation. That innovative spirit is sitting behind us right now. You think about what we're able to do in the amount of time with the workforce here from Northrop Grumman, the collaboration with the United States Air Force, to bring in a capability using a digital approach, which is new and different from anything we've done in any major program, that's part of the Raider spirit. We'll have, I understand there'll be some of the family members, Doolittle family members will be here this evening, and so the Raider spirit lives on, and so appreciate you asking the question.
Great. I think we are actually out of time, and as you can hear, the music is starting, so we are starting to make the preparations for the ceremony to begin. Again, appreciate you all being here. I know you're going to be well escorted to an area where you're going to watch the ceremony and the unveiling of the B-21 Raider. Thanks for being here, everyone.